One day, when the glory comes, it will be ours. It will be ours.
You may write me down in history with your bitter, twisted lies. You may tread me in the very dirt, but still, like dust, I'll rise.
Does my sassiness upset you? Why are you beset with gloom? Because I walk like I've got oil wells pumping in my living room.
Just like moons and like suns, with the certainty of tides. Just like hope springs high, still I rise.
Did you want to see me broken? Bow head and lower eyes, shoulders falling down like teardrops, weakened by my cell phone cries.
Does my haughtiness offend you? Don't take it awful hard, because I laugh like I got gold mines digging in my own backyard.
You may shoot me with your words. You may cut me with your eyes. You may kill me with your hatefulness, but still like air, I rise.
Does my sexiness offend you? Does it come as a surprise that I dance as if I have diamonds at the middle of my eyes? Mi sensualidad te ofende? Viene como una sorpresa. Que bailo como si tuviera diamantes entre mis piernas.
I am a black ocean.
Leaping and wide.
Welling and swelling, I bear in the tide.
Leaving behind nights of terror and fear.
I rise.
Into a daybreak that wondrously sweet.
I rise.
Bringing the gifts that my ancestors gave.
I am the dream and the hope of the slave.
I rise. I rise. I rise.
Hey guys, welcome. I'm hoping that you guys are having a great day, and we are here to talk about all the great things that we did over the course of Black History Month. I have a wonderful cast of wonderful people here that you all know. But first, I would like to open up with Mr. Ellison. He helped spearhead a lot of the great activities that we had during Black History Month.
Hello, Wiley Charter School. First off, I'd just like to thank everyone who helped in the Black History Month Committee. First off, Mrs. Ellison, Ms. Nixon, Ms. Mitchell, Mr. White, Mr. Kamara, Ms. Herzog, and Ms. Batista. When you see any of these staff members during the course of the day, just let them know how much you appreciate them. The goal of our Black History events were based upon the committee's mindset that our students need to be educated with some real life scenarios and show them that one of these scenarios might just include them. Every student here is vulnerable to what you might learn today. Just a recap of the different activities that you might have seen or been a part of in the school setting. We did the African American Daily Fact of the Day from Miss Ellison every morning. The door decorating contest. The movie, The Blood is at the Doorstep. The reenactment of segregated bathrooms, water fountains, staircases, and the lunchroom, and even the protest. Ms. Herzog's after school program, the youth justice explaining school to prison pipeline and the juvenile justice system. Explaining why Black Lives Matter and why was it originated. The soul food buffet, if you missed that, sorry guys, you're gonna have to wait till next year. We also had a live traffic stop with our very own Mr. Natal. The Maya Angelou poem as well. And Mr. White's advanced media broadcast class capturing pics of students recreating the civil rights movement.
Hey guys, we're really excited to share with you guys some of the things that we did over the last course of last month. And Mr. Ellison, what are we about to watch?
We're getting ready to watch a live traffic stop by our very own Mr. Natal, Eugene Rivera, and Derek Singleton.
Fritos, Cheetos, and Lay's.
No way, Cheetos are way better.
Nah, Cheetos give me sticky fingers, and I don't like...
You gotta pull it over.
Oh, no.
Put your hands on the dashboard right now.
I gotta get my license.
Put your hands on the dashboard.
You wanna
right
see
now.
My license?
Follow my command.
I need to get my license.
Put your hands on the dashboard.
Stop.
as of right now, the young man should stop and listen to whatever the policeman has to say. He has to comply with any directive that is given. If he's told to put his hands on the dash, put your hands on the dash or put it on the steering wheel. Everyone else, just look forward, don't say anything, don't use any vulgar language or inappropriate language. Listen to what he's saying. Follow directions. Let's try this again.
Doritos are better than Cheetos, Fritos, and Lay's.
No way, man. Cheetos are way better. I've been told you this.
Nah, Cheetos give me sticky fingers. Everybody relax.
Let me see your hands. Let me see your hands. Get out of the car. Get out of the car right now. Let me see your hands. Get out of the car. Stop. Stop. As you can see, sometimes when you are doing the right thing, it goes south.
Hey guys, that was really powerful right there. You know, these are some things that we actually deal with and that we definitely have to share with you guys because, you know, I'm sure as a father, Mr. Ellison, you have to share those things with your kids.
Absolutely, Mr. White. That is a conversation that I have with my son every time that I see him. Make sure that you're complying with any policeman. Make sure you put your hands on the deck, on the steering wheel. Listen, don't say any inappropriate words. Just follow the directions.
Yeah. You know, having a proper relationship with your community, it starts with making sure you have respect for dignitaries within the community, but sometimes things go wrong. And, you know, we did organize a sit-in for a movie, Blood on the Doorstep. Miss Ellison was instrumental in making sure that that came about. Why did you decide on that movie for them?
I think since we were steering towards focusing on Black Lives Matter, that movie fit the overall what we were trying to do.
Okay, well, let's check out the trailer for this movie and also see the kids that we took out to the movies. And let's check it out right now.
Oh, one day when the war is won, we will be sure, we will be sure.
To the heavens, no man, no weapon formed against, yes, glory is destined. Everyday women and men become legends. Sins that go against our skin become blessings. The movement is a rhythm to us. Freedom is like religion to us. Justice is juxtaposition in us. Justice for all just ain't specific enough. One son died, his spirit is revisited.
Dontre was a big factor in our family.
Working with Dontre got me into this crap.
He was like a smooth dude. So in high school, he had a little perm. Dontre was a person who didn't deserve to die, who didn't deserve to be shot 14 times.
1246, shots fired, officer involved. Starbucks, help right now.
You don't know this, but when somebody gets killed by a police officer, whoever gets the information out first is the winner.
Subject began to beat the officer with the wooden baton.
They stick to this mental health issue.
He was diagnosed with schizophrenia.
Because when you hear mental health, you think this was a crazy person who attacked the officer.
It's an illness. It's nothing that anybody should die for.
We're not gonna continue to accept what's going on in the black and brown communities around the nation.
To try to fit it into the national narrative, this doesn't fit the template. And there were a lot of bald-faced opportunists who decided it was a race story.
Why couldn't you just talk to him?
The testimony you're about
the
to
attack was so quick and so violent. I really felt like my brains were coming out.
I would say I'm a non-confrontational person, but they're not taking it serious.
This community's at risk all the time.
We have compassion for the family.
It
It's not because men and women in blue risk their lives protecting.
If the chief cannot stand before the membership, then maybe it's time that he packs his bags.
The whole system has a mental problem. So when will we stand up?
The blood is at the doorstep.
Welcome back, guys, and wow, right? That documentary.
That was deep.
Yeah, I mean, just, you've seen the trailer, but if you could actually see the movie, I mean, I was moved by it. And, you know, I certainly do remember us sitting down with those kids.
Yes.
And asking them certain questions and just seeing their responses to that and what they felt about mm-hmm. it. And mm-hmm. what they felt triggered that particular situation.
And all the students had said that, you know, it was very racially driven. You know, you have a young man that was shot 14 times. You know, he was an individual that had special needs. And, you know, he didn't have a weapon, but he was shot 14 times.
Yeah.
So it was definitely racially driven. So...
even though they didn't want to say that it wasn't, you know, I know that that's what I picked up for sure.
Yeah. So I, you know, and I think about it, you know, I think about this all the time. You know, have I ever experienced a situation where racism was present? And I have. How about you guys? Have you been in a situation?
Absolutely.
Yeah, I definitely have.
I remember being in fourth grade, playing football. Played against Boyertown. Boyertown, at that, you know, was known for, you know, being a racist area. We played football down there. It was I was playing for Exeter. I was the only player of color on the field. We had the ball on offense. The quarterback was starting to say the signals, and this was after during the course of the game, I had about two or three touchdowns. I was killing. And I heard a kid, you know, he yells out, "Get that nigger!" And the whole place stopped. You could have heard, you know, a pin drop. So the referees looked around. They were looking at each other. Everybody, you know, was looking around. And it was more of a traumatic situation for me because I'd never been in a situation like that. The referee called a flag, but still, it was okay. This is me against everyone what I felt like it was me against the world right then and there. Mm. And I never expressed that before. How about you guys?
I know for myself, I did. It was at a very young age, and it really enlightened me. I was in fifth grade, and I'm home at my mom's house, and she's doing cooking, and that's what my mom does. She's always cooking. So she sends my cousin to the store. My cousin goes to the store, which is literally at the corner of my house, just to pick up a few supplies for his mom. Unfortunately for my cousin, he was in the wrong place at the wrong time, because right before he got to that store, the store got robbed. And they called the police, and the police showed up right around the same time my cousin was going into the store. And later on, my cousin eventually gets arrested as soon as he walks in the store, as if he was the one who robbed the store. Now, quite frankly, I'm not a robber or thief or anything like that, but I know one thing. If anyone robs a store, they're not going to go right back in there in 5 minutes afterwards.
Right.
So my cousin was profiled. Unfortunately, he was profiled. To finish off the story, in a couple of minutes from him leaving my mom's house, I just hear a big knock on the door. And we weren't expecting any visitors or getting guests or anything. And I'm the one who answers the door. And as soon as I open the door, I see this 6'2 police officer. And then I see behind him my cousin in handcuffs. And for me, in fifth grade, I was really a young kid. I was really, really new to it because I was born in Africa. And then I moved to America, and when I got to America, I really didn't understand the racism that was prevalent. Unfortunately, sometimes it gets swept under the rug, but it's here. So long story short, the person who ended up robbing the store wasn't even a minority. So unfortunately for my cousin, like I said, he just got put in a situation. Quite frankly, there's no other way to explain it. I don't think. And that was the first real experience that I had visualizing racism. As I grew up, I had these experiences happen to me as well. Yeah. But that really, really hit home. And that really helped me realize that it's really, really here. And that I have to really, really move a certain way. Yeah. I have to talk a certain way. I have to make sure I fit into our environment and make sure I don't do anything that's going to stand out in a sense where it can bring any kind of negative light to myself or any of the people around me. So till this day, I hold that near and dear to my heart, and I'm always cautious and really, really making sure I'm paying attention to what I'm doing.
Well, I mean, as you can hear, this definitely is something that sticks with a person. When you are attacked in some sort of way, and when you know that attack is coming towards you to degrade you and you know, make you feel less of a person, but with racism, it goes deeper than that. My personal experience was in middle school when my little sister, was attacked by a woman and her son. She was spat on, she was kicked and called the N-word repeatedly. You know, I went there, you know, as a little guy, trying to do whatever I could do to get this woman off of my sister. And, you know, I wasn't able to, but luckily my mom wasn't too far off and she was able to come to the scene. And, you know, that woman went running off, called the police, and them police came out to lock someone up. And it wasn't that woman that they were had any intentions to lock up. They were trying to lock my mom up. And if it wasn't for, you know, some people in the neighborhood that witnessed the situation, my mom would have went to jail because, you know, in this situation, the police officer just saw, you know, a black family out in the street, you know, upset about a situation. And to him, we were disrupting, you know, the peace, disturbing the peace. So, you know, that's my experience, and these type of experiences are definitely something that's traumatizing. And, you know, we just have to go on with our lives on an everyday basis as if these things don't exist around us, and try our best to, you know, coexist in these type of environments. So,
but I think in my situation, I grew from it because, you know, to this day, and students come into my office, the N-word is not allowed to be used. I correct students when they come into the room because a lot of students don't understand that. They think that, oh, it's a term of endearment. No, it's not a term of endearment. Once you watch the videos and once you watch this documentary, you will see that many of the people that heard that N-word might have been the last word that they ever heard. So that hits home with me. That's the traumatic situation that I got from being called the N-word at such a young age, that today, being in the position that I am in, I carried along with me that, no, you're not going to use that word in my presence, and no, you're not going to use that in a common conversation with me. So,
well, you know, on that note, you know, I think that just as you did, making it clear to the kids that this is not some type of language that you should be using at all, rather it be in front of me or anywhere else. Mm-hmm. So I thought it was important to make sure to get the students and some of the students in my classroom was able to experience an opportunity to see themselves in the moment, you know, see themselves in history. And I would love to show you guys that. It was a project that we did in our classroom called See Yourself in the Moment, where students would use graphic design to Photoshop themselves into an image. But we did a lot of other activities to put the students in the moment, you know, to allow them to experience it from their vantage point. So you know, the some of the other ones that we did.
Well, we did the live traffic stop.
Yes, sir.
We did the prison to pipeline breakdown. Those were two key parts in the you know, the Black Lives Matter.
We also did the lunchroom. We did the lunchroom scene.
Yes, know? The lunchroom, which was probably my favorite.
Yeah.
And what came about the lunchroom protest was bigger than what we thought it was going to be.
Yeah, because the kids started to create a protest.
Yes, and unbeknown to us, we didn't know it was happening.
Nope.
They did it on their own.
They knew. And you know what? Let's just let you guys watch.
Let's check that out.
Let's check it out.
Pero vea, que por qué día $1 cuesta eso. Yo lo doy.
You're gonna make me starve of thirst because I'm gonna
do what I'm saying.
I'm waiting for him to
be
done taking a picture.
They don't want to. They want to use the water fountain.
Estoy cuidando eso.
Let's go with the bracelet.
Oye, mira, yo tengo unos brazaletes.
They didn't let me go to the bathroom because they said I need a green bracelet.
For what?
They said that I have a bracelet. I could use the bathroom.
What was the reason? Just because of the bracelet?
Because I'm white. Because I'm white. I'm telling you.
Is that what it is?
Yes.
Yeah.
I think personally it was crowd control. Like there was like it was getting crowded. Maybe.
That's what it was.
And this school is small and there's a lot of students, so.
Hmm. Wanna give it a shot again?
You want me to try again?
Yeah, why not? I'm in here now. Might as well try.
Try again?
Let's see.
Wait,
let's try again.
You have a bracelet.
No.
I'm gonna get three.
No, you can't.
You see what I mean?
Because
I'm white.
It has nothing to do with your color, honey.
Yes, it do. Look. Oh.
You see that?
You're in Canada.
You see that?
Okay, I got
I'm
one.
Hispanic. That's why.
And I'm black.
It has nothing to do with color.
Not even the bathroom or get a drink up here. We have to go downstairs.
So you know the
bathroom?
Since I have the green bracelet,
you see that?
How come he has it?
How come? Because I'm special and important.
You know, you see that?
Special egg.
Only the special people get. That's what happens.
Bye.
And all the other black people that went through all that have to like do all this, right? I'm gonna use the bathroom. You get it? You get what I'm trying to say? If like you know how like Rosa Parks, she fought for the front of the bus. You know how Martin Luther, I forgot what he fought for. You know how Malcolm X, everybody had a purpose to fight for something because it wasn't fair. I'm about to go to that bathroom because I don't find it fair. How I gotta go all the way around, take the other steps because I don't got a bracelet.
Does anybody have eyes on Mr. White?
If you don't have a bracelet, then you see on the stairwell.
That was so strong. What's
up with y'all? Oh, they're filming a documentary.
On the stairwell. On the stairwell.
Maldita vida, ya me están pillando. Oye, no sé mi bracelet.
Is that a bracelet?
No.
All right, on the stairwell. You can't go
this way. This is braces.
You can go this way.
You can't go this way. Stay over there. You know what?
No, I'm black.
I'm black.
No, you're not.
I'm leaving.
Take a little jump to step up.
Let's
head in.
Let's go, Memphis.
You guys, do you have any idea why they, what they doing?
Like a street
market. You don't know what it's for?
Huh?
You don't know what it's for? Like why they're open?
I mean, they're just having relaxing and eating. Yeah, you see that it's eating.
No, but like I thought it was something else.
We protested. I ain't like this. I'm talking to you. I'm sorry. I don't want to talk to you.
What the?
Mommy. Sorry. Mommy.
I understand. You feel some type of way.
I'm
What'd you say?
I said, imagine if everything was like that. Like, everything.
It was like that.
See? All of y'all are sellouts. Oh my God, you guys are sellouts. Segregation is a lie. Segregation is a lie.
You're mad because you can be here. Jealousy. Shut up, delinquent. No, go. Go. You gotta go.
Why are you guys doing this?
Because this is segregation is not right.
It's unfair.
I can't use a fountain. I can't go down a stairwell.
Wait, so you're saying that it's unfair? That we pay and you didn't? That's unfair?
Yeah. It's really unfair.
Allison! Oh my God. Come back, come back!
Yay! I'm not getting
a got two people over here. They don't want to leave.
And that's not right. I can't walk in that hallway. I can't go up that stairwell. I can't use certain dollars.
How does that make you feel?
It makes me feel more like messed out. Like, not included.
So this was the point of doing this exercise.
Because, like, why did you decide to do this project with the students?
Well, I think all students should feel that pain that people, and the struggle that people went through.
Yeah.
And I think that was very successful because there are students that it disrupted their whole entire morning because of this little exercise that we did.
Take it out, with.
We shall overcome. We shall overcome. We shall overcome.
Sit on the floor. One at a time, guys. One at a time. We're trying to video it. So why did you come over?
This is not fair. We're all equal. We're all human.
We're all human beings.
You're all human beings, but you know
our
that
color is not supposed to defer us.
By your choices right now, you're going to be linked in with this crowd that's not allowed to be over here. So you're willing to accept those consequences?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Y'all realize money all about your stuff, right? Y'all realize money all about your stuff.
Take it, take it. Do you guys see how you guys booed us at first and you was booing us and all that? And now you guys came to join us? We're gonna accept. We're only gonna accept you guys because we don't wanna be like how you guys were to us at first.
I love you, black people.
Would you change? Would you change the thought process then?
Wow, guys. The students are really something, you know? I mean, when we sat down and talked about doing this here lunchroom experiment, you know, we did not expect that those students was going
to... Wow. They seem to amaze me.
I think we wanted that. Yeah. In the back of our mind, I know we wanted somebody.
Yeah, we were cheering. We were cheering as it was going on. We were cheering.
You know? I mean, I saw the look in your eyes when you came down. And I know you must have felt proud because I definitely felt proud too. And they were asking me, Mr. White, what's this all about? You know, I'm just like, well, how do you feel about it? And you could kind of see from the footage that the students were definitely concerned. They
They didn't care that it was about, you know, a wristband. They like, why are you separating us this mm-hmm. way? You know, and that was what it was all about.
And the thing that really, really moved me was during the lunch, the students that had the band stood up and were tearing off their band
yep.
to sit with those that didn't have the band.
Great job, and, guys. Yes.
And, the compassion that they had, and, you know, it really made me feel good because, you know, when I asked the students, I said, well, why are you ripping off your bands? He said, because it's not fair.
Yeah.
You know, yeah, they had the best area. They had the VIP setting.
That's right.
They were able to go down the steps or any steps that they wanted to.
Mm-hmm.
But it was just that, you know, their peers couldn't do what they could do, and they felt some type of way, and it was very powerful. It was very powerful.
It was definitely powerful. Listen, great job, guys. You know, you did a great job with that experiment. I definitely got to give a shout out to Christian, who stepped up and said, "Hey, listen, guys, we should protest this." Great job on that. I think we should definitely highlight some of the other activities that we did here at Ile Charter School, just recapping Black History Month. Some of the other things was a lot of artwork done here. There was some beautiful stuff done here.
Yes, the door decorating. You know, we didn't have that much participation. But the ones that did participate, they were very stunning.
Yeah. So we're going to check some of that out. I want you guys to first see some of the graphic design work that my students did in the Broadcast Journalism Digital Media class. This is the pictures where the students will see themselves in a moment. And I also show you guys a couple of the pictures that I put myself in the moment as an example for the kids. And then you'll get to see what the kids were able to pull off.
Say it loud. We've been built and we've been scorned. We've been treated bad, talked about as sure as you born. Just as sure as it takes 2 eyes to make a pair. Brother, we can't quit until we get our share. Say it loud. Say it loud.
Next, guys, there's a student named Ashley who was able to pull off in a beautiful art piece. And let's check that out. There was also one done for Mrs. Eisenberg.
Ms. Eisenberg, yes. Yeah, on her door. Mm-hmm. It's a great piece. It tells a nice little story. Ashley's stood out very, very much.
Let's take a look at that. As you can see in this here piece, all of the names of the people who lost their lives innocently. And as you can see, this piece is definitely a beautiful piece of artwork, and I love what she did, and I thank her for participating. Take a look at that. That's wonderful, right, guys? All right. So there was other ones that actually did the door contest as well.
Yeah, I think Ms. Herzog's class did a great job.
Yeah.
They definitely highlighted a lot of important things throughout the door decorating contest, and it's so interesting to see how you guys do a great job of learning through arts,
mm-hmm.
you know. So all of the learners who did participate did a great job, but the most important thing was the fact that they educated themselves.
Right.
And that's what we need to continue to do as a community, as a school, is strive to continue to educate ourselves, especially you young learners, continue to learn more about Black History Month, learn more about all different races and ethnicities, so you can be sensitive to certain things that they're sensitive to.
Right. I think I remember hearing you say that it was compelling to know that these students actually did the research and brought it all together.
And that's the biggest part of it, them digging deep and learning about it, not just knowing what happened, but knowing why.
Right.
Why's behind the what's. So that's how you educate yourself. And as you continue to educate yourself, you're going to learn more and be able to be desensitized to a lot of different things. So I think that the main goal was to continue to educate while doing this, mm-hmm. and I think we hit that goal.
Yeah, we definitely did. I know with my class, you know, it was definitely compelling to see the kind of pictures that they chose and them ask those questions. Well, why did this happen? And then them going actually to do some research and seeing, you know, the intense history that we have here. But we didn't just stop there in the arts. We invited a wonderful poet, Mr. Ellison invited a wonderful poet to stop at I Lead, and he did a fantastic job.
Yes, Edeheme Frankie came through and blessed us with a couple of his pieces. One of the pieces that he performed was not his piece, but it was one of his best friends, who was a national poet on the national level, mm-hmm. and he performed in honor of him. He showed how the N-word was used as a negative, whereas, you know, though the gentleman on the end was being chased by someone, and it shown that it was used as a negative, not a term of endearment, like I mentioned earlier during the documentary. But you could see how that, you know, that tied into his total piece.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, he did two pieces. One of the pieces he's really well known for,
I Am Poet. Yeah. Yes.
So let's go ahead and take a look at that.
My name is Edeheme. I'm going to be doing a poem by Will the Real One Bell. He was a mentor to me. And he has a poem called So I Run. I will do his poem first, and then I'll do my poem. His poem is called So I Run, and I tweaked it a little bit. As he travels backwards through time, he searches to rescue all his heroes and finds himself in the Underground Railroad standing side by side with Harriet Tubman as she decides whether to go left or right tonight. As the barking dogs approach from the south, he rubs his clothes from 1,000 slaves on his body and he hands her a flashlight and he runs. He runs till he gets to Jackson, Mississippi and is June 11, 1963, and standing in the bushes is a white man in front of him. And so he peeks over his shoulder and he can see what he sees. So he screams, "Look out!" And from a distance, he could hear the shouts, "You better run, nigga." He runs till he gets to spring 1963, and he's in Birmingham, Alabama, peeking through a church basement window, four little girls and four little worlds, and he noticed that he's standing next to a box and he can hear the sudden sound of a tick-tock. So he opens it up and cuts the red wire to make the bomb stop. And he can hear coming from the block, and they're screaming, "You better run, nigga." So he runs. He runs till he gets to the night of February 21, 1965, and he finds himself standing backstage at Manhattan's Autobahn Ballroom trying to explain to Malcolm that the enemy has sent four goons, and is explained that, yes, Malcolm, we know change is going to come soon, but so he looks for a few of Malcolm's security people, and they just cleared the whole effing room. And all of a sudden, the CIA showed up screaming, "You better run, nigga!" So he runs. He runs till he gets to April 4th, 1968 in Memphis, Tennessee. And he's standing in front of the Lorraine Motel with Dr. Martin Luther King. And shots begin to ring. And he just don't want to lift every voice and sing. So he scoots back and he covers Dr. King with his own body as they hit the floor. Because today, that's the only damn Jesus he's willing to die for. And he hears the screams across the street again, "You better run, nigga!" So he runs. He runs until he finds himself standing in the middle of the intersection in Las Vegas on September 7th, 1996, the day Tupac was being followed by an entourage, an eyewitness, and everybody claimed not to see it, so he ran alongside the passenger side and pulled Tupac out, so Suge Knight was the only mofo to get hit, and he heard the scream again, "You better run, nigga!" So he runs. He runs so fast that in a split second, May 29, 2011, years and months have passed, only for him to arrive back in Miami, a town enough to push him away from the gun blast. So lying here, thinking, oh God, at last, he ain't gotta run no more. He ain't gotta be no one's nigga no more. My name is Aheleme, and this is my poem called I Am a Poet. It's a poet's anthem. It goes like this. I'm under the impression that you think I'm nobody, that I'm beneath you. I speak with my eyes and touch with my mouth. Sí, así mismo. Hablo con mis ojos y toco con mi boca. My words travel through you and touch you in the most important spots, your mind and your heart. I bring blank pages to life with rhymes, passages and mind tunnels every time I grab a mic. I'm a lover, a rapist, a killer, a racist, an actor, a junkie. I'm gay, I'm straight, I'm white, I'm black, I'm gray, I'm day and night. I could bring tears to your eyes and make the dead come back to life, give goosebumps and hives. I can give feelings to things that don't even have nerves. I can give you what you want and what you don't deserve. I am the one lying, the one dying, the one surviving. I am the one crying, just crying to be heard. I captivate no beats or haunts, just my words. I bring revolutions, solutions, and evolutions. I create resolutions, and I can make you feel alive. I chisel little by little and break down those words that separate our minds. I inspire the ones to compose, construct, and design. Create from raw material a mental act and verbally customize lyrical compositions. I'm the reason for verbal abuse, the grim reaper of lyrical misuse. I'm your mental muse who choose to put your mind on cruise to knock those words loose. Simply put, I'm a verse, an idea, an artist with a twist. I'm Shakespeare, Allen Ginsberg, and Patricia and Mark Smith. I'm Miguel Piñero, Pedro Pietri, and Miguel Algarín. I'm Mudo with Tupac Shakur and Justin Chin. I'm Che Guevara, Jim Morrison, and Nicky Giovanni. I am Jose Martí, Lolita Lebron, and Umar Bin Hassan. I am Bob Dylan, and Mumia Abu-Jamal. I am under the impression that you think I'm nobody, but I want you to admit that whatever I spit to get you to quit thinking that I am nothing yet. I am what I am and say what I see fit, because I am a poet. Thank you.
Wow, guys. Wow.
Powerful.
That is powerful. Thank you for coming out and doing that. For ILEE Charter School students. That was actually done right here in my classroom, broadcast journalism, 7th block. You know, their reactions to hearing him shout out the N-word that way. You know, Mr. Ellison was here. What did you think about their actual reactions to that?
At first, I was taken back because when it was used in the context that Aheleme used it in, some of the students didn't react in a positive manner, right. But as he went on and you were able to feel his words, it, everyone in that room started to put themselves in his place and they looked at it a totally different, because at the beginning, there were students that giggled a couple times at, oh my gosh, he said the N word, but when he showed that it wasn't a term of endearment.
Right.
It was used as an attack.
That's right. A moment to run. Mm-hmm. You know, yes. This is when we hear the N word, it feels like an attack. You know, so it feels like, you know, just as he showed through at that poem, you need to run.
Yes.
It's time for you to run for your life sometimes. So thank you once again for sharing those wonderful poems. You know.
One thing I did want to say, I'm sorry to cut you off, but one thing I did want to say was Frankie is now retired.
Mm-hmm.
He's on a national level, and he had said that he would come through anytime and mentor any student that wants to be in, that wants to do poetry, that wants to perform, that writes music. He writes music as well. So he said that he would come to iLead, because he's not a stranger. In both of our buildings, he has always come through our to our building and volunteered time and engaged with our students. So we should definitely utilize his talents, because he definitely is. He definitely is has a talent, God-given talent.
Right. Well, guys, that's not all that we have for you. I definitely want to mention Ms. Herzog. She has worked with her students during Black History Month and did some wonderful things with them as well. She requested that we share a documentary with you guys. As you can see from what we've been showing you, as a nation of people, we are dealing with not only threats just from random situations that we run into, but you know, sometimes there's some threats and with the police. There are some threats that, you know, lead to death, you know, lead to people being injured, but there's also some threats that lead to you losing your freedom.
So, Mr. White and Mr. Kamara, what way can we get out of that? We can get out of that hole by having our education. When we get our education, we can steer or go any way we want to. But if we're in the pipeline from high school to prison, we can't steer which way we want to go. We only can go one way if we're in that system. Right. So this is why we keep telling you guys to stay in school, educate yourself, get as much education as possible so you can go on with your life and make yourself better.
Right. Let's take a look at this video.
In Pennsylvania, Black youth are 9 times more likely to be incarcerated than white youth.
We are Youth Justice Association. Our mission is to educate and advocate for juvenile criminal justice reform with the focus on preventing juveniles from ending up in an adult criminal justice system. To succeed, we plan to utilize support systems in the community and encourage relationship building between the youth and the community.
If you're interested in joining our mission, we meet up at the school on Wednesdays in room 2210. Please see Mr. Blowers or Ms. Herzog to sign up.
When you walk into a facility, all that you see is a sea of black and brown bodies.
Racial injustice is evident, you know, within these youth prisons.
It's mostly African-American males. It's obvious.
It's hard to try to argue that it's not a racial justice issue.
You see these two white staff all of a sudden just rushing into the room. All of us just standing there and watching, you know, my friend who was African-American, you know, being beat down by the staff. I'm like, why'd you go and do that? And he's like, what do you care? He's like, at the end of the day, kid, you're only here to pay my paycheck. In that moment, I realized I was just seen as a dollar sign to this man.
I would define structural racism as a hierarchical inequity that is characterized by white supremacy.
If you have any questions about what structural racism looks like, I encourage you to walk into a juvenile prison in America, talk to the black kids who are in those facilities, and ask them what their experience has been in the juvenile justice system.
When the 13th Amendment abolished slavery, it actually kept an exception for people who were convicted of a criminal offense. And so the criminal justice system and the juvenile justice system became the new vehicle for controlling the lives of people of color.
After the Civil War ended and we saw this influx of African Americans exercising what they deemed as their freedom, immediately we saw institutions go up, these youth prisons be built to house young black African American males.
Post-Emancipation Proclamation, you know, unfortunately as a whole, as a country, we thought it was our opportunity to do away with racism. We thought that we'd gotten past that particular issue. And through sharecropping, through Jim Crow, through segregation, the drug epidemic, we find that, you know, society, especially here in the U.S., we just reinvent that issue.
It's almost like it was meant to be. Like at no point in our history would black males be completely free.
So Virginia is indeed the heart of the Confederacy. You can walk down on the James River and stand in the very place where black lives were bought and sold. You can walk the slave trails.
Some states highlight the fact that their institutions have been around for hundreds of years. And I, you know, that's certainly like a slap in the face for our brown and black allies. And I think it's disgusting that a state would highlight the fact that their institution has been around so long in the heels of the end of slavery.
The Beaumont facility was built in 1890. And when they began incarcerating young people there, those young people had to work the land, much like slaves.
New Jersey happened to be the last northern state to abolish slavery. The New Jersey Training School for Boys was opened in 1867. That's 2 years after emancipation, after slaves were free. And they put a process in place called gradual emancipation, which meant that children who were born by slave mothers had to work as indentured slaves until they were young adults.
In Kansas, we're also the state of Brown versus Board of Education. To be able to go just a few miles from the Brown versus Board of Education school building to the Kansas Juvenile Correctional Complex, our one remaining youth prison, and walking in and seeing the racial disparities in that facility, again, it's just difficult to walk away from that and not feel like we have a special responsibility to fix this and fix this quickly.
Our youth prisons were created at a time when human bondage was legal, a time when whites were willing to see blacks as less than human. Young people will come into these facilities in leg irons and shackles. There's been incidents of correctional officers actually hog tying. Some facilities use something called a restraint chair. You know, everything that they do, they're being watched and they're being controlled and they're being deprived of their own agency and their own worth.
When you look at some of the communities that are the highest committing to the juvenile justice system, they're impoverished communities. They are communities that are struggling economically. The school systems are failing and there is a lack of hope and opportunity in those communities. And it is just a reflection of the way blacks were treated when they were first brought to this country on slave ships.
And so what we have a system right now, one system of justice for white youth and for, you know, upper middle class youth, and then one system of justice for poor youth and youth of color.
The kids know, you know, I mean, they are aware that the color of their skin affects how they're going to be treated. I don't see people who look like me behind those bars. I don't know how you can say it isn't a racial justice issue.
I feel like the movement is ripe. The time is now for this message to get out that this is no longer just a juvenile justice issue, but a racial justice issue.
I see a sea of diverse faces who come to a place because you, like me, know that change, when it happens, it always, always happens from the ground up in our communities.
My hope is that we can fight for a world where no young person is locked up, where young people have the opportunity to be their full self, where young people have the opportunity to live their destiny and to carry out their dreams. That's my hope.
Okay, wow, that video is definitely something that I think that everyone should see, and I hope you guys got out of that what we would love for you guys to get out of it. You know, I know as a teacher at Ali Charter School, I care for each and every last one of you very much, and I want to see the best for you all, as I know these gentlemen do here as well. And we do not want to see people, any of our students, lose their freedom or lose their life. So, you know, a lot of these messages that you are seeing here, you know, the message screams true.
It's real life.
This is real life. These are the realities that we have to deal with on a day-to-day basis. And, you know, Black History Month is not all about that, but these are the revolutionary things, that lead to those revolutionary moments like Black Lives Matter. You know, so there are a lot of people that lost their lives innocently. And, you know, Ms. Herzog actually highlights some of that there here as well. Take a look.
I looked over Jordan, Lord, what did I see? Coming for to carry me home. A band of angels are coming after me. Coming for to carry me home. Swing low, chariot. Swing low, chariot. Swing low, chariot. Coming for to carry me home. I'm sometimes up, Lord. I'm sometimes down. Coming for to carry me home. But still my soul feels heavenly bound. Coming for to carry me home. Swing low, chariot. Swing low, chariot. Swing low, chariot. Coming for to carry me home. If you get there before I do, coming for to carry me home. Tell all my friends, Lord, I'm a-coming too. Coming for to carry me home. Swing low, chariot. Swing low, chariot. Swing low, chariot. Coming for to carry me home. I looked over Jordan, Lord, what did I see? Coming for to carry me home. A band of angels are coming after me. Coming for to carry me home. Swing low, chariot. Swing low, chariot. Swing low, chariot. Coming for to carry me home. I'm sometimes up, Lord. I'm sometimes down. coming for to carry me home. But still my soul feels heavenly bound, coming for to carry me home. Swing low, chariot, swing low, chariot, swing low, chariot, coming for to carry me home. If you get there before I do, coming for to carry me home. Tell all my friends, Lord, I'm a coming to, coming for to carry me home.
Wow. So once again, guys, you know, there it is. So, you know, we hate to end on that sort of note, family, but at the same time, you know, we want to make sure that you guys are aware of these things and sensitive to those things as well.
Education, that's all I'm going to say. It starts with education, and guess what? It ends with education. I've been saying that for years. Just think about that. It starts with education and ends with education. But if you don't start with education, guess what? You're going to be in that pipeline. And that pipeline isn't going to a great place.
And for all the students out here that are watching, my message to you would be great. And always do the right thing. Regardless of who's around you doing negative things or having negative interactions, everyone knows the difference between right and wrong, especially our students here at Ivy Charter School. So don't be afraid to be that leader. That's what this school is about. It's called I Lead because we're looking for leaders.
That's right.
Go ahead and be great and be a leader, regardless of who's around you doing anything negative or whatever the case may be, whatever situation you are. You guys stand up for what's right.
With that being said, guys, we hope that you enjoy the rest of your day here at Ivy Charter School. You guys have any final remarks?
I just want to say thank you to Dr. Romanello, Mr. Gerber. Also, I want to thank the committee, and I also want to thank the staff for helping us and assisting us through this Black History Month. Even though Black History Month isn't just 1 month, we like to extend it. That's why we're doing this documentary today. So we just want to just thank everyone, and just remember, you guys matter. I Lead matters. Education is key.
That's right. Hey guys, that's our Black History Month recap. Till next time, peace.
See you later.
I've been walking with my face turned to the sun. Weight on my shoulders, a bullet in my gun. Oh, I got eyes in the back of my head, just in case I have to run. I do what I can when I can while I can for my people. While the clouds roll back and the stars fill the night, that's when I'm gonna stand up, take my people with me. Together we are going to a brand new home, far across the river. Can you hear freedom call? I can feel it in my bones. Early in the morning, before the sun begins to shine, we're gonna start moving towards that separation. Thank you.
salvation, and I fight with the strength that I got until I die. So I'm gonna stand up, take my people.